What? Can you see everything?
Hello, how's it going?
Okay. And you can hear as well, right? Is it Matthias? Okay, Haven, Astra. Okay, let me pause here and let me ask you, what are you thinking right now?
Right, so I'm basically thinking I'm gonna be like acting as like a sentinel kind of deal for a C site. I'm looking at my everyone's position on the map. I'm like, all right, that looks fine. If it's an A hit, I'll rotate to garage, thinking about picking up my stars and like look at the rest of the map. But for now, I'm pretending I'm a sentinel.
Okay. And your layout with the two stars so far, what are you thinking you're gonna accomplish? Are you gonna
All right, so I'm gonna maybe jump peek C long. If I see someone, I'll like keep shoulder peeking, try and bait some shots, then pop the star that's furthest away from me. If I feel pressure, util coming in, I'll pop the one closer to me as either like a suck or a stun, and then fight with my team who I assume is coming through to help me. Yeah.
Okay, that sounds good. All right, I think all you said was pretty good. Only thing I would like to say is that you don't really press tab to see like what your team's loadout is,
Okay,
and
yeah.
plus around is not a huge deal, but on other rounds I definitely want to see tab more often to see like because basically how your team buys is going to dictate whether you buy or not, or whether you buy or save, as well as your playstyle. So if someone is like buying a big gun, for example, they're buying a rifle, but maybe you're kind of broke. Let's say it's a force buy round, and maybe you can only afford a marshal or something, or a guardian or a bulldog or something like that. And ideally, what you want to do is that you want to play near your team or near the people who have the big gun, so that if they were to die or if they were to get a kill, better yet, then you would be in position to get that free gun upgrade.
Yeah,
So that's just
all
like
right.
one example, but definitely try to press tab more often because that gives you more information, more awareness about like what to do.
Covering it, taking that back.
Yeah, awesome, actually. Pause this right here.
Covering it, taking.
So we see four people on the minimap. We see all five. Perfect, we see all five. Now, what are you thinking here? What comes to mind?
I'm thinking, okay, I'm looking at my Phoenix and I'm like, okay, so my Phoenix is going to be like, I guess cutting off via rotates back. So if it's a fake, well, no. So I'm thinking I'm gonna take my setup off C and rotate as fast as I can to help out.
Okay. Which way are you
Yep.
going to rotate?
Through spawn.
Okay.
Or actually through spawn is slower. I don't know which way I actually rotate in game, but usually my default is through spawn.
Your CT spawn?
Yes, through CT spawn, yes.
Okay. I think you do have a lot of options here because you've seen all five people. That means you know exactly where all five people are, and you know that the rest of the map is basically free. And based off your Phoenix's positioning, Phoenix is in a really strong position because he cuts off flanks, and he gives you the option to basically like run with your knife out to wherever you want on the map. Like the whole map is like basically secured until Phoenix dies or makes contact. So knowing this, if your goal was to get to A site as fast as possible, you can do so by like running through B sites. That's usually the fastest. CT spawn is usually reserved for if you lose control of B, or if you just need to rotate as safely as possible but take a longer route, so that's the trade-off. Then yeah, you can rotate through CT spawn.
Okay.
But here actually, I think the best play would be either to group up with your Phoenix so that if the enemy team like rotates out, then you can play off your Phoenix and like basically hard shut down any rotates. Or if they do commit to A, then you and your Phoenix can kind of box them in at long or lobby or sewers or even A site, basically like play A site for retake. And they get boxed into the site, and they have to deal with like 3-4 different angles.
Of course, yes.
Or you can also play a bit more greedy and be like, well, I have all this map control. I can go grab the orb at Sealong and then group up with Phoenix, or then group up with like my jet outside of East site or something like that. Right?
Wow. Like, that thought never even crossed into my head.
Because you know that the Sea Orb is like, it's free right now, so you can just like run over there, pick it up. And it does slow down your rotation, but it's a bit of a game mode to see if your team is able to like stall them for, I don't know, maybe another, at least another 5 seconds or something. Maybe each stage lands like a big ice or something like that, or something like that, where like you can grab the orb, then rotate to your Phoenix, and then kind of gauge the situation. Maybe they were turning out, okay, great. You sit somewhere in T-spawn, or maybe they're hard coming into A, great. Then you push with your Phoenix, you box them in. Mm-hmm. But whichever you choose, you have to let your team know that you're grabbing the orb, or you're taking a long time to rotate over, and that they should try to like not die. The worst that can happen is if both Sage and the Sova like hard commit to A site and they both die, and now all five or between 3 to 5 enemies are on A sites, and then now it's like a 3v3 or 3v4, 3v5, whatever the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
But it's much better to like retake as a full team rather than just like half a team.
Yeah.
Okay, so I have those options outlined and see how you play it. Okay, like this, knife out, run as fast as possible. Okay, now what are you thinking?
I'm not sure what I'm thinking. I don't know why I ran into that corner. Maybe my stars, yes, okay, no, I know why I ran into that corner. My stars are coming up and I wanna like and my instinct is to get into like a hidey hole to put my stars up. I want to put one star at short and one star inside a long or at the entrance. Yep.
Okay, so basically put another star at a long and then one star at
sewers, yeah.
Okay. Yep. So going back to what I mentioned earlier, that where you had the two options where you either regroup with the Phoenix or you grab the orb, like grabbing the orb, that greedy play would have actually paid off right now, because your team has like basically held down A site and the enemy team has not pushed into A site yet. So your help is not necessarily needed yet. I mean, you could put stars down, but you can also put stars down across the map. You could be getting the orb and then put stars down. You basically accomplish the same thing.
Yeah.
The point of you rotating over is so that you can like provide yourself as like a body with a gun, but right now that is actually not quite needed yet.
Yes.
So actually in this situation, what I would do is that I would run over to the Phoenix and expect the enemy team to start to rotate out, because it's been at least 10 seconds and they haven't hard committed yet. So it's very likely that they're going to just going to like think, oh, this push is shut down. Because there's a Sage here, because there's a Silver Arrow, and because there's a smoke here, maybe a couple more smokes coming right after that. Maybe it's a better idea to just rotate out. That's kind of what I would be expecting from the enemy team, what they're thinking.
Okay, yes, I understand. Yeah.
Okay, so let's see. Okay, so now we group up with Phoenix, but now it's too late. Now it's too late because now Phoenix has like already fought this 1v1, maybe possibly even a 1v2. And then loses it. And now the enemy team has like all this map control again.
Yeah.
Okay. So what are you thinking at this point?
Now I'm thinking, crap, they're probably going to do a fast rotate to C, and so I need to get there as soon as possible. I still have my two stars in my inventory. I can probably stall for my team.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all.
Let me present to you another option, because that the Sage was the person to make first contact with the Phoenix, and Phoenix just died. And what you could do is that you can run to grass like right now and like hide beneath window, or hide outside of the, what's it called, like the bottom of mid, the like T-spawn part of mid, right?
Okay, yeah.
And then basically just listen for footsteps. Either they do what you said, they're going to run all the way to C long and then take C. If so, then you can let your team know, hey, all 1, 2, 3, 4, or whatever number that you count, footsteps, like unique sound signatures, you can say however many are going to C-long, and then you can plan for a retake with your team, where like you could be looking behind them, coming from C-long, and then the rest of your team can come from garage, and then also from CT spawn. Therefore, you're like, you're maximizing the number of angles to C site.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that's option one. The option number two is what is if they don't go C long, if they instead push out through mid, maybe they peek out a window, maybe they peek out from bottom mid and start heading to a garage or something. But if that happens, then you'll be in like a very unsuspecting position, right? You could be like some random position and holding some random corner that they might not expect it.
Yeah.
And by you being in like these positions, it greatly slows down like their push, because they have to like clear all these angles because someone could be there.
Yes, yes. No, of course.
But it is slightly riskier because like you kind of be there alone until someone can like come B or someone can come in to trade you out if something goes wrong.
Yeah. I guess I don't do that kind of thing because I'm not extremely confident in my mechanical skill, and I want to, and I kind of rely on the ability to like make contact, fall back, that kind of thing. That's my that's my like modus operandi, I guess.
Okay. Then I think in that case, your best middle ground will probably be running into garage, and then peeking out of the garage doors. So either you see people outside of garage, or you hear people outside of garage, you hear people from mid-window or mid-grass, you can relay that information to your team, or you don't see anything, you don't hear anything, that kind of implies that they're going C-long, or less likely they've gone mid and cut noise.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so these are all various options, let's see what happens.
They're rotating to C, I think.
Yep.
One enemy remaining.
Okay, so we've made the wrong gamble. We've gone to C site, nobody has gone C. And then engagements have happened already. Like one person actually stuck around A, two people stuck around A, Sage fights the rain in mid, and then like we're nowhere near to help any of our teammates.
Yeah.
Actually, Sage is in the 1v2. Managed to win it.
Right, heading to you, Sage.
But like, imagine if, for example, if we were sitting in garage instead of like going, rotating all the way to C-long, or to C-site rather, right? Where like Sage is fighting this 1v2 against this Reyna and Sentinels in mid. Knowing that, you can like push out of garage doors and like shoot people in the back because they're super focused on your Sage right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like Sage fights the other Sage plus the Reyna, so it's a 1v2. And she managed to clutch her out, but really, it could have been a lot easier for her.
Right, heading to you, Sage.
Yeah.
She's here.
He's on site.
Are you coming to the CC party next week?
I get interrupted, yeah?
Yep, go ahead, sorry.
I know, I get interrupted by my sister here.
Oh, okay,
she's like,
in game.
Yeah, she comes into my room and like at that point you can hear her voice in the recording and like it's bugging me, so I kind of like stop playing at that moment.
Yeah, that's okay.
Yeah,
so at this point we know the last person is outside of B, right? In view of your Sage. Tiny thing is that you should pick up your stars immediately because they're no longer used for at C.
Yeah, Sage, of course.
And then another kind of mini gamble is that you know where the last person is. You can technically still go C-long, grab the orb, and then return to your team to help out.
Right. Always about controlling the resource, yeah.
Right, because orbs are super important, and especially in Astra, where like your ultimate is like can basically win rounds for you.
Of course.
It's like extremely powerful.
He's here.
He's on site.
Are you coming to the Christmas party next week?
I'm concentrating.
But let's see, actually, so while we're here, Sage rotates out.
Huh?
I actually don't like this position anymore. This was a good position
right,
when Sage was still at B.
Okay.
When Sage was standing here, this is great, because you guys got a crossfire right now.
Sorry.
When Sage backs off to the other side of B, this is no longer that great. This is kind of okay. Yeah. At this point, Sage gives up that angle completely, like, Right here, she's still semi-holding an angle. So you still possibly might get a crosshair with the main. Also, by the way, you're like wide in the open. You should at least hug the corner to your left. So it's a bit safer if you needed to like break cover. Like if this Rainer swings out, Mavi wins you, you're like committed to that. And you'd be relying on your Sage to trade you out.
Mm-hmm.
But here, because the Sage is like no longer holding any angle on back of B sites, now what I'm really afraid of is that this Rainer is going to swing out and then 1v1 you. And then one's going to be able to trade you.
I'm concentrating.
Right, do you see that? Like,
yes, if she was looking at me and killed me, that, yeah, suddenly it's a losable round.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I definitely would have liked you to like play a more passive angle as soon as Sage like gives up her angle, so that if something happens, then you can always fall back and then disengage. Always have like an escape plan, right? Right now you don't have any escape plan.
Yeah, for sure. Maybe I could like play a little bit more to the left and like cut off the angle like just before, so I could watch the cross between her location and the front of B, I guess.
Right, I would do that.
So I could be more towards the left and then like, I don't know how to explain it, but I would watch like that wall where she's crossing now. And so that I wouldn't necessarily take the fight. I would just
okay. We're at B. Reyna's here. Here's Reyna. Actually, let's draw an R for Reyna. And then we're here. We are let's draw an A for Astra. And then Sage is here.
Yeah.
Right? So when Reyna steps out, you'll have a direct 1v1. And you're far away from this corner, and you're far away from this corner.
Right, yeah.
So ideally,
I want to be closer to... Yes, exactly.
You'll be here, so that you look this way.
Yes. That's what I meant.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Okay. Okay, back to VLC.
Are you coming to the Christmas party next week?
So, you get the kill, it's great, but it could have been a bit smoother.
I don't know, sorry. Double star down on your side, so, yeah.
Simmer down, Babylon, follow me! That's wet.
At least from here, I can kind of see who has guns.
Double star down on your side, so, yeah. Down,
so, well, I don't know what Sage has, I know what Silver has, but I see that Jet has a pistol, and or it has a ghost rather, and Phoenix is a specter. Okay, so now Sage is fully loaded with pistol and specter. We don't know what Silver has yet. One thing I like to do on second round, after we win pistol round, is basically bonus with someone's pistol. So for example, Sage's ghost. Because Sage already has a specter, most likely she doesn't need a specter and a ghost. So you can use the ghost, or maybe you can give the ghost to your Jet. Well, actually, I'm not sure if Jet died last round, but maybe you can use the ghost and kind of bonus this round, because you don't necessarily need like all five people to be fully loaded. You just need just enough to win the round. Then the next round, you can like bonus again, or you can like buy a real gun, like a rifle. Which makes the bonus round, the third round, typically the bonus round, like a lot more winnable. Cool. Just some food for thought.
I'll rotate to garage to help you out.
Like this rotate tiny bit here. You're focused on Silong, which is fine. But then like here you're actually peeking garage. You're peeking garage. And now we start to turn to look at the door. We don't know if someone was actually like outside the garage door. We could have just died already.
Yes.
Okay, so this is really bad. The Sage is dead. She went a little too greedy by looking behind, but at least now you know that someone's in mid-window, and you know that they have a Spectre.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is not likely to be the Sage, because this person just shot at us with a Classic. So that means that there's somebody window the Sage, and now there's somebody at bottom mid, I guess. Can't remember what the color is. I guess bottom mid.
Yeah.
So when picking this, be careful, because you're also exposed to the window.
Yeah.
Yes, this is a bit better. Now you're not exposed to the window.
They're short.
Yeah.
Okay, who walked back? Okay, that was a solo. Okay.
Yeah.
Reloading.
Spike planted. Unfortunately, okay. Your solo didn't make any callouts until the bomb was already planted. And now he's going in by himself, which is really unfortunate. And now he's dead. One thing I like to say is some comments. Maybe you can try to be the Eagle for your team and be like, "Hey, Sova, wait for us, we're rotating." And if he dies, okay, fine. The next person, "Hey, Phoenix, we're rotating, wait for us." I mean, he trades out the Sova, which is fine, but here he's like peeking for a really long time. Peeking for a really long time while you're like semi-close, but then also your jet is like nowhere near the action.
Yeah.
Okay, so now it's just you and the jet. What are you thinking in this situation?
Well, I'm thinking I'm gonna die. Because like I'm on my own on site against three people. My jet's like 15 seconds away. I was trying to like get close to like trade out my Phoenix, but I overcommitted. Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's see. We're running in to try to trade out Phoenix, and then this is a fine peek to try to train him out. But then here you go further. You're like, "Oh, I'm gonna commit by myself."
Yes. Okay. So that is definitely my mistake.
So that is a mistake here. And the second thing is that now that you're semi alone, but Jet is like maybe 10 seconds away, you can just like start to plan your star setup.
Okay.
Whether you're gonna pull this, you're gonna smoke that, you're gonna concussion this or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's what I like to see, like set up, and then when Jet gets here, then we can like pop our stars and then like hit, like execute together.
Yeah.
Yeah. But here we stay too long. We die with two stars available.
Yeah.
The other option too is that even if you didn't put the stars down, is that they don't know that the jet is coming behind them. Let's see, she doesn't actually kill anyone, right? Yeah, she doesn't actually kill anyone on her way from T-spawn to C.
Yeah.
So really, like, she has element supplies, so all you really have to do is just, like, keep paying attention, where, you make some noise, and you spray the omen, you peek out, you jiggle, whatever, maybe you head to heaven or something, you reposition, you make a bunch of noise there, like, "Hey guys, I'm in heaven, look at heaven. And then the jet can get like a free kill off somebody who's overly paying attention to heaven. Maybe she gets a kill at sewers, maybe she gets a kill at A-Long or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Then it becomes more winnow, then it becomes a 2v2 instead of a 2v3.
Yeah.
Last player standing.
But here we commit way too hard.
Burn bright. You can pull by next one.
Personally, I don't like buying a sheriff if you're holding C long. You might as well just buy a marshal, because it's basically a sheriff with a scope on it.
Okay,
At this range, like, you're gonna lose every gunfight against every gun. There's also no point in jump peeking, because you already saw somebody at C long.
Yeah.
That person who's at C long is just gonna hit you with a marshal.
Wants to learn window?
Yep, just like that. Well, even worse. C-long? Hit you with an op.
Just tag 50.
The whole point of like jumping like that is to gain information if somebody is there. But you already know somebody is there, so there's no point in like continuing to jump peek. You're just kind of like asking to get shot.
Yeah.
We get eyes on that omen, then we that thing.
Okay. Actually, let's go back to that because you do have stars available. One thing you could have done.
Wants to learn that.
Or did you have something? You had no stars. Oh, that's unfortunate. You didn't buy anything. You gotta buy stars. Well, you had you bought
I,
two.
I put two drones. Yeah, I used them. But I didn't pop them. Yeah. I think I should have popped them as soon as I saw the. I don't know. I'm not sure.
I think you should always have at least one star in reserve so that when you see something like an opportunity, then you can put the star down immediately and play off of it. So one thing I would like to say is that if you know that there's a marshal or an opera at Silong, you know they're going to peek you, then you put a star like right where they're standing. Or maybe you even put it like directly behind them so that they don't actually see it because they're too busy scoped in. Then you then you like you do a suck and then you peek out. Then it becomes like way more winnable because like they're too focused on like the suck, they throws off their aim, and then they're too busy trying to like get out of it. And most people, they don't really know how to deal with it. Really, the best option for them is to like let go of the keyboard and then take the shot. But people don't really think about that. They just like they just think like, oh, I need to get out of the suck. And then in doing so, you can just take like a whole bunch of free shots with your with your deagle. But you only have that option if you just blow up your stars at the beginning.
Just tag 50. Servo's long.
One of them has a whole thing.
They're pushing
guard. Good kill. I would get the hell out of sight like right now. Yep. Alright. They maybe ask you to search for a heal. Okay. Thanks. Automatic. And then start planning another star. And then start rotating to B. Because Silver needs help. Alternatively, you can push off your Phoenix outside of garage. So we know there's two people B mid grass. Okay, never mind, it was just the omen. Here I'd run with a knife out, so you can get there as soon as soon as possible. You know for sure that nobody's heaven, so let's go back to here. Here you had your knife out. You bring out your gun because okay, maybe somebody could be in like the A kind of link kind of doorway. Then Sage peeks it, so now we know it's 100% safe. We should whip out our knife to run as fast as possible to heaven.
Couldn't it be possible that like Jet updrafted heaven, or am I missing something?
If that was the case, then you would hear it.
Okay, right.
Either
right,
you or the Sage would have heard it.
Mm-hmm.
Spike down A.
Too slow, you want to trail your Sage? You're too focused on that arrow. Here we just wait. Yeah, now I actually will drop down.
Nice.
So you always want to think about like a red light, green light kind of deal, where like where like your Sage is like peeking out, she's exposed. You need to be like ready as possible to trade her out. There's something would happen here. You're like you're too far away because you're too worried about this arrow, which is not going to scan your enemies because it's on the outside of this window. But Sage finds herself in a 1v1, dies, and now we're too slow to trade her out. Here. We kill the Jet, great. As soon as you get a kill, the general rule of thumb is that you should reposition. Although, because it's like a 3-1, this position is like, it's pretty strong already, then staying here is fine. We just wait for our team to regroup. But basically, after you get the kill, you play like, you assume it's a red light, right? You just like, you wait. Until there's an opportunity. And then, the opportunity is eventually going to show itself where, okay, now a Silver makes contact. Once we see that the enemy is like occupied with something else has grabbed their attention because now that the Silver is like really focused on your Silver, your team Silver. Now that's a green light. That's a green light for you to like make a play aggressive, or do something, right?
Yeah.
In this case, your best option would be just jump out the window. Now the Silver has to like really be careful about both you and the Silver like peeking at the same time.
Yeah.
But here, like, because you're staying in the window, then the enemy Silver can just like isolate 1v1s by using the sight boxes. Right? So for example, here here, this is a 1v1 that's happening. You can't do anything about it.
No. Yeah.
Like, that Sova can kill your Sova, and you can't trade him at all. And you would just be stuck in heaven.
Yeah.
And then here, now he's 1v1ing you, and now your Sova can't help you at all.
Yes.
Right? So, like, that enemy Sova is, like, playing really smart. He's, like, using the cover in sight to isolate 1v1s.
Yes.
I mean, you managed to get the kill, but it could have gone very poorly. He could have got 3 1v1s in a row and then basically clutched around.
Who wants up?
Probably give it to your Jet.
You want up, Jet?
Although, you are playing C-Long, so up is really strong for C-Long. That smoke is a little too deep.
Okay.
You know why?
Because they can like get the space like right in front of the smoke, I guess, and then use it to like peek people, right? Like, okay. I should form a wall in front of the entrance.
Alright, let's talk about smokes.
Yeah.
Most of the time, your smoke should look like this. Why? Because when the enemy pushes through,
screen is frozen. I can't see what you're streaming.
About to change my screen. Okay. Let me start over. Oops.
Okay. Yeah.
Let me start over. Most of the time, your smoke should look like this. Why? Mm-hmm. Because when enemy pushes out of the smoke, they have one option where they can come out of one of these places, and when they do come out, they're exposed to as many angles as possible. One angle, two angles, heaven, third angle, four angles, five angles, six, seven of graffiti, maybe some of the boxes, like 10,000 angles, as well as people on top of boxes, this box, that box, that box, whatever, right?
Yeah.
There's like 10,000 angles that they have to worry about as soon as they leave the smoke. Now, let's imagine you do your smoke, which is like a bit deeper, right? And then they push out. Well, now you have to worry about one, maybe two, maybe three.
Yeah.
Maybe four if someone's on the box. But it's much less compared to this kind of smoke where they push out, and then they have to deal with all these angles at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
So you want to like make it as hard as possible for the enemy to push through smokes.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, let me go back to VLC so I can hear the volume. Okay.
Does one see long rotating now?
Yep.
Okay. Let's go back to. We were originally thinking we were playing B. And then we spot some action of A. Spot some action, we pop some smokes.
Consume it.
We're still kind of holding B, but now. Now we start hovering toward A. Which, on paper, it makes sense because, like, oh, you're thinking, I need to help my teammates at A. But if you look at what Phoenix is doing, Phoenix is making a play right now. Phoenix is pushing out of a garage. That means there's no point, or well, less of a point of this right here, where, like, you're worried about someone pushing through B, which is less likely because unless they're already like up grass, they're not really going to push into B into your angle. What I would probably do is take a gamble that, my Sage and my Sova, they should be able to hold A pretty easily. Or at least they should be able to delay it pretty easily because Sage has put like basically the most optimal wall at sewers, like that kind of like a horizontal kind of thing that the enemy has to break like multiple comments to push into sewers. Actually, she should have put it a little bit deeper, but okay, it's fine. They still have to break at least like two columns, and you have a smoke there already. I would even consider putting another star just in case, and then pushing out through B to help out Phoenix.
Yeah.
Because Phoenix is like he's making a play right now, but like nobody is able to help him.
Does one C long rotating now?
Like, hey, well, we're just sitting A-Link and we're being completely useless. We're a global controller, we can put stars anywhere on the map.
39.
But now, like, Phoenix has already made his play, he's died for it, and unfortunately there's no one to train him out or anyone to even get the map control that he just got. Well, secure the map control that he just got.
Looks like he's rotating today.
Flushing now, we're too late. Now A has fallen.
You've got mail.
Yep, hit the wall immediately. I would break at least two columns so that it makes it easier for when your team retakes and pushes through. Otherwise, you're kind of funneled through that one column entrance. You're also kind of waiting too long. So while we're kind of looking here, Silver is already thinking, I'm just going to peek out of heaven. Even though it's not really the right play, because we should be waiting for our jet, like he's doing anyways, we should be ready to peek off of that. Like, imagine if we swung as soon as Silver died, then maybe you can get the trade on the Reyna, because we know exactly where the Reyna is. Reyna's like corner of graffiti. Okay, hopefully you push right after this instead of flying back, because you look at your jet's also going to do the exact same thing, going to peek out of heaven. When this happens, we need to peek as well. Nope, but we're following a jet, which is not the right play. We're double stacking and not taking advantage of multiple angles. I mean, like, you get two kills, but like, you could have let your jet get those kills, because like, your jet's like originally peeking, and then you peek out, and then she's like, well, I need to go to a different angle. Okay, now it's totally winnable if you guys play fast. Play super fast.
Last player standing.
Okay. So, multiple issues this round that kind of snowballed. One is like your Phoenix makes a play, and then you don't really do anything to like play off of that. You kind of sit in A-Link for no reason. You kind of like 39. Accomplish nothing. You might as well just like hold B or like push to B or something.
Yeah.
Here we like, we break one column. Ideally, we break two. Okay, fine, not a big deal. But then, like, Slow is about to peek. We're not playing off of him. Then, Jet is gonna peek, and then suddenly we decide, oh, we're gonna peek with the Jet at the same position. Which is not really ideal. Okay, so next round. I think your jets as an op, right? Hold on, let's go back to the...
I think she died to the bomb.
Okay, she died, unfortunate. Hmm. Okay, we see two people in lobby. Again, that smoke is not that great.
Mm-hmm.
We see at least two, possibly a third. We saw Jet and Reyna. Okay, we're for knife rounds.
Two pushing garage.
Okay, looks like a bit of a default then, okay. Okay, what are you thinking in this situation?
Thinking maybe someone's gonna push out at like hop up into garage window and like push out into like B link.
Okay.
Or C link, I suppose it's called. Yeah, so I'm just gonna hold for them.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. I think generally when you're down players, like here you're 3v5, you actually want to try to take more risks to either even the numbers so it becomes like a 3v4 or 3v3, or to gain more information. Because right now you have no information. And ideally your jet should be like relaying information to you, like, hey, I hear people in garage, I hear 1, 2, 3, how many people, or I hear people in grass, whatever. But if she's not getting the information that you need, then you can also try to get the information that you need. So maybe you can like kind of just push into garage window and like hold a close angle so that as soon as they jump into the window, then you can kind of like spread them out at close range. But here, you're like mid to a little bit longer range where you're probably going to lose a gunfight if they have a rifle.
Yes.
Okay.
They're on C then.
Okay, so you know at least two people on sites. We have the Sage, we have the Sova. Spike planted. Yep, we want to play on a drone. The drone makes fixed contact, we peek in, take the map control. You could probably force this 1v1 right here. Too slow. Your gun is not wall bangable. Okay,
yeah,
great. Jet takes a kill that you should have taken. Now we know for sure that the site is clear, so there must be C Long. Or at least two of them must be C Long, the Sage and the Sova. The Jet is still unknown, so Jet could very well be lurking. She could be pushing B and then coming from CD spawn. She could be pushing B, maybe coming from garage. Possibilities.
And yeah. Mm-hmm. Jet doesn't appear in my head at all at this point. Yeah. I just assume that they're all three at C Long. And that's the mistake I make this round, I think.
Yeah. So what I would do, I like the wall idea. What I would do is that I would wall off C Long, then put a smoke at garage. And then like based on like where the bomb is planted, the bomb's planted on CD side. In that case I would just kinda say whether CT spawn or garage is more important. I guess as long as you smoke off one of them, that'd be good enough probably.
Yeah.
Then you don't have to worry about one angle. Which like the one angle that is not smoked off. Okay. We do a wall, great.
Wait.
Yeah, we got a jet because we weren't thinking about jet.
Yeah.
So that's the issue.
A couple long cables.
Okay, we have four guns. It's kind of hard to see because you don't really press tab enough. Okay, we have four guns, and I'm assuming Jet's gonna use her knives because she has ult. Okay, great.
Jet's kind of throwing this game, so she only buys shorties and ult.
That sounds like a winning strategy to me, because there's basically nothing else to buy except operators. I'm assuming she's gonna pop knives. Okay, there we go. Okay, so Phoenix is a great pick. We see somebody in lobby.
Here, I feel like they're playing a default, so I don't rotate.
Fallback server.
Okay, now there's two coming A, and the third is unknown. So again, we can take a gamble and say that the third person is with them, or maybe the third person is lurking. That would be the gamble. So like we can like push through C-Long, grab the orb, we can push through C-Long, go T-spawn, we can push through garage, and then take control of mid, whatever. Because worst case scenario, we run into the Omen, we fight a 1v1. If we win the 1v1, that's a huge reward. Now we have all this map control. It's like completely under your team's control. You can tell your team, hey, rotate to whatever that you want with knife out so you can get there as fast as possible. And like you basically like you win rounds with like securing map control, right?
Yeah.
Or the alternative is like you fight the 1v1 and then you lose. But that's lower risk, I guess, compared to like the reward, the huge reward that you would get. Like if you win that 1v1, you basically win the round. Like almost automatically. I need a stop. Vision. Here we're like we're really passive, we're really worried about this omen. Okay, Sova's still at A because he darted. And now Jet is doing what we should be doing, which is like pushing through and looking. Okay, now we know for sure the last guy is A.
Enemy
remaining. Now we know for sure that C is completely clear, so there's no point in holding this angle.
I think my brain's like a little bit off at this point.
You know, okay, now for sure you see on the minimap. Nice. Yeah.
Good stuff.
So one thing is that while you're sitting here, you're not actively watching angle. Like you're not actively watching angle until you actually peek. Let's say like you peek here. Like this is an actual peek. This you have to pay attention to. Like something could be in front of you. You could be in a gunfight, whatever. But 5 seconds ago, we're completely behind cover. You can just like spend your awareness cycles on the minimap. Just constantly look at the minimap. What is happening around the map?
Yeah.
And now that should tell you like what you should do like right now. Whether it's like, oh, I should lurk, or like what your options are, I can lurk, or where the last guy could be. Maybe like there's some ability that gets thrown out, therefore now we know where everyone is, right? And that should dictate like how you play.
Yep.
One enemy remaining.
But here we're like, we're not really looking at a minimap.
One enemy.
Okay, let's start to take some notes here. Because I'm starting to see some trends. Okay, that's from the previous VOD review. Okay, so one issue is that not paying attention to minimap generally low awareness.
Okay.
Two is not playing off our team, and this is is built off number one because we're not paying attention to the minimap. We're not realizing that our teammates are peeking or our teammates are like pushing up. Therefore, we're not really able to push off our team.
Yeah.
Teammates are making plays, but we are unable or too slow to follow up.
Yeah.
Let's see. Those are two main things so far. Afraid to look. It's another one. Let's say like these are the major ones.
Yeah.
And these are kind of the minor ones. I mean, like looking is kind of 50-50. It depends on what kind of gamble you want to take, etc. But definitely, like, always be thinking about can I look and how risky would it be and what would my payoff be.
Yeah.
Okay, and then so far, minor issue is playing out in the open. I mean, it happened in a couple of rounds, but not a big deal yet. We haven't been punished for it yet. Like, positioning, we have been not near cover. Third is playing committed angles. This ties into the two. Okay, that's what we have so far.
Mm-hmm.
Remaining.
Okay, so I think this round's over. Okay, nice.
Got a target concealment.
Okay, interesting smoke on mid.
Two mid.
One thing I like to say, kind of minor thing, is that try not to put your stars in the same spots every single round. So far, you put the same two stars at C long, and even then, these two stars are not really necessary because they're so kind of close to you that if you do spot someone C long, you can spend a few seconds, put the spars down, smoke it, and they still wouldn't like have time to actually push through yet.
Okay, right. Yep.
So like it's a different story compared to like if someone makes contact at B or something, and then they were like from close, they're already up grass, and then they make contact, and then okay, then you don't have time to put stars like that.
Got a target concealment.
Is anything wrong with that smoke at mid?
Not necessarily. Okay. The only thing I would criticize is that there's nobody able to play off of it. So you're smoking mid, which is great. It's buying you map control, but currently, mm-hmm. there's nobody to actually push, because ideally if you smoke mid, you want to have someone push through mid so that they gain map control. Maybe they can get into like mid cubby, like left side of like by the box, like going straight to the left by the box. Or maybe they can get underneath the window. Or maybe they can like, it buys your Phoenix some space. So maybe he wants to make a play and push out a garage, that kind of thing.
Yeah. Because my thought process behind the smoke is to like isolate the people who are pushing out of B and like deny them, like force people to stop playing in window because it looks like they're coming in for a B execute.
So in other words, you're trying to slow down and execute from window.
Yes.
Okay. That makes sense. It's just like kind of low to medium value compared to if someone was actually able to play off of it.
Right.
It's like, see, like you smoke mid window and they just don't give a shit about it. They just push the smoke.
Exactly.
Okay, and this sounds like a hard execute because Sage just walled. Most likely she walled either into sight or she walled off garage, which kind of implies that the enemy team is going to like hard commit to B right now. They aren't ready. So actually, I would hide back site like you are here and start to prepare some stars, because you're gonna need stars right away for this BXQ that's incoming. Yep, here's a flash. Here's the ice wall, here's smokes. Hopefully you ideally want to calm all this to your team, so you say like Rainer flashing B, Rainer insight B, Sage okay. icing B, smokes yep. B, or smokes like a C-Link, or not C-Link, like an A-Link. So you let your yep. team know like, okay, more and more enemy utilities being thrown, more and more enemies are coming B site. This sounds like a B hit, I need to rotate ASAP. I mean, your yep. team kind of does it implicitly, but you should still relay this information to them, because they don't know that a smoke is going down. They don't know that Sage Ice is coming this over here.
Right.
Maybe they're
right.
still thinking, oh, Sage is A lobby, or Omen is still A lobby, and he's like pushing or something. Everyone kind of implicitly rotates, but Jet is also not on the same page either. Jet should give up C completely, and then rotate to either cover garage or maybe just like hard commit and stack with B with everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
Spike planted. I need a stack. Pulling them in. Concealment.
I'm watching backstage. I'm joining.
Okay. Yep. Actually, yeah. Perfect. I would just keep the wall there. Okay. Never mind. No longer safe. Let's get out. I would smoke this off. Yeah, you have star. You don't have stars, never mind. Where did the stars
yeah,
go?
I should have picked them up earlier.
Oh, yeah, you still have stars at sea. That's why. That's why you don't have stars.
Mm-hmm.
So this minor mistake is starting to become a bigger mistake, where like... number three... need to pick up stars ASAP. When you realize they are no longer in a useful position. Need the Sage res? Why did you res? I feel like it could have been winnable. Okay, maybe she was on site or something. Oh, it was just too late. Oh, okay, never mind.
To whoever's screwed that round there.
Obscuring vision! Someone's mid! Again, low to medium value smoke. Imagine if you smoked off contact with your Phoenix, made contact with the Reyna, then you push to mid. And now the Reyna has to deal with you, and it has to deal with Phoenix at the same time.
Yeah.
Okay, Jet needs help.
Reyna
ASAP.
Spotted me, I think.
Jet needs help. Reyna. Too slow. Jet could be dead already. So like here, like we're jiggling mid. Okay, where is it? Okay, we're jiggling mid. Here now, on the kill feed, Jet gets a kill, and then also on the minimap, Jet like we. The tiny difference between you're holding an angle. Here you're holding an angle. Here you're not holding an angle, right?
Yeah.
Here you're holding a really tight angle, jiggling, and then we're not holding an angle. While these brief like intermissions where you're not holding an angle, again, look at the minimap, look at the kill feed, see what's happening around you. So that if yep. you realize that Jet got a kill, Jet's being pressured because now the Silver Dark probably tagged him, like mm-hmm. she needs a star, she needs a smoke like ASAP, or she needs like a concuss or like whatever help that you can like throw at her.
Reyna spotted me.
Like I'm actually surprised she managed to get out, because she didn't have her dash, or she didn't use dash or whatever. Like right after that shorty, I would expect her to dash out, but
Reyna
she doesn't dash out, so I'm surprised.
I think
she didn't die for it. But now Phoenix is on site. Like when did he get here? Yeah, so like, see, Phoenix has really good awareness. Like, as soon as Jet gets that kill, he rotates, like, ASAP. That's right, what I want to see from you. He rotates ASAP, he throws himself at C site. But it's like, it's kind of too late, because, like, now he's alone.
Yeah. And if I had reacted, like, I don't know, as soon as it, I would have hit that suck, wouldn't I have?
Yeah, if you hit a suck, you hit concussed, then, like, maybe that Phoenix could have got, like, a double kill or something, which would have been huge. But instead he rotated over early and then like got punished for it. Okay, well, we're just looking at nothing. We're looking at nothing. We know the bomb's planning C. We need to get in position to like get ready to execute with our team. Like Sage is ahead of us already. Like Sage, like rotated all the way from A site. And then we're just looking at our star, Imagine if we actually looked and paid attention, like rotated over and like got ready and before I actually execute, I have to break this wall. But now we're wasting like a few seconds off our smoke.
Yeah.
Now we're too slow because again, minimap, Jet is already on site. And somehow she gets a kill, which is huge.
One enemy remaining. That's the stack, 79.
Nice. Now just stick it. Yep.
Nice, guys.
Fine.
So again, issues in awareness, issues and like not really paying attention to the minimap. Again, you're still in like these in limbo where like it's in between of like a useful angle versus a completely useless angle. Like you're just sitting in like C-Link and not getting ready to do anything.
Taking that back.
Nothing see long so far. Oh, Sova. 3 C long.
Wait, how many of this 3?
Oh, Sova. Oh, Sova. 3 C long.
Let me pause here. How do you know that there's 3 C long?
I know that there's at least 2. But I'm not sure. Maybe I heard like 2 different gunshots and I know that the jet had an op, so I immediately assumed 3.
So far I think the only information they have is that there's an op with C long.
Right.
That's the only thing that we've seen and it's the only thing that we've heard.
There's 3 on C. Well, Sova's there, right? I saw the drone. Oh, Sova.
Oh. Okay, you're right. There was a drone.
Oh, Sova.
But again, while we're like sitting here backside C, look at the minimap. Phoenix is like making a huge play again.
Yeah.
What we should do is like we should group up with our Phoenix and then like just like give up C probably.
If they remember actually thinking this at this moment in the game exactly. I'm like, I must the right play here would be to run at my Phoenix, right? But then I don't do it.
Yeah, you have either you run at your Phoenix or you position yourself in garage so that you can do double duty to some extent where like you can continue pushing, like you can push out of garage and group with our Phoenix further. If he says oh, I hear people rotating out of C and soon he's gonna be in a gunfight, or let's say he says oh, I hear somebody mid window, then you can like help him if he wants to double peek mid window, or you can help the jet if she wants to peek mid window, or because you're still in garage, you can like play sort of a off angle. If the enemy team decides to like hard commit to C and just like push through your smoke, then you can like abuse the off angle from garage instead of sitting back sight. Whereas like you sit back sight, you could very easily become overwhelmed. Like Jet can like dash updraft into your face while Arena throws a flash into your face while like multiple people like push out of the smoke. And then like maybe you get a kill, but even if you do get the kill, you're most likely going to be run over before you can get to safety, which would be CT spawn.
Yeah.
But if you were in garage, then you can like break line of sight like immediately. Well, like you get one pick or you don't get a pick, whatever. You make contact, you spray, whatever. And then like then you just stay in garage and you just like hide there or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Or maybe you like after that, you push with your Phoenix.
But, if I was doing that play, would I still smoke? Would I still smoke C-Long like I did here?
If the which play?
If I ran into garage and held it from garage, would I still smoke C-Long?
Yes.
Okay. Yep.
Do you know why? Or should I explain?
Explain.
So you still want to slow them down from C. So like you don't want to like make it seem like C is completely open. You want to make it seem like somebody is still in C sites, like you jump peek like a bunch of times, so they would expect you to continue being at back site, right? Yeah. And if you smoke it, now you could be anywhere. You could be anywhere in sight. And by smoking it, they have to worry about multiple angles, which like puts some sort of delay to their push. They can no longer just think like, oh, I just need to keep my gun, my crosshair pointed at back sight, and that's all I have to worry about. But because you smoke it, not to worry about many more angles, you could rotate anywhere. And they're probably not even thinking about garage. Like, they're not thinking about like the off angle from garage. Like, you could be in garage. They're probably thinking that you could be in C-site.
Yeah.
So yeah, you still wanna slow down their push. And by slowing down their push, that also buys more and more time for your Phoenix to continue making a play.
Yeah.
So on the other hand, let's say for example, if you don't smoke off C and you make it seem like it's wide open for C, so then they just like hard W into C, now your Phoenix is gonna find himself to be like his play might be like become too slow. Because they're already like in C site while he's like slowly walking up behind them at C lobby or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any more questions?
No, I don't think so. Yeah, okay. Yeah. The play is to support my Phoenix for sure. They're three on C long.
The play is to improve your positioning.
Ah, yes, of course.
So again, like, Phoenix is in a fight. We know where to help him. Jet's in a fight. We're nowhere near to help her. Imagine we could have double peeked the Phoenix. We could have double peeked the Jet already and killed the guy in window. Now Phoenix is in trouble. Like, he's getting flashed. Somebody has to shoot the eyeball. He has to shoot it.
Not long anymore.
You just said nothing C long anymore. So what are we doing at C then?
I'm nervous.
Yeah. So too slow.
Mm-hmm.
So all this happens because we're nowhere near the help out team. We're too nervous, thinking like, even though we don't see anybody C, we're like, oh, I need to keep staying C. No, you need to think about the map control. What map control does my team have, and what can I do to help? Like secure that or even get more map control. You will not kill my ally. So we originally had control of mid, so let's see. Somewhere around here, like Jet's peeking mid with the silver, I think. Anymore. Okay, never mind. Jet rotates out. Originally we have control of all this area that Phoenix has control for us, and here we have control of mid window. Because silver is peeking mid window.
Mm-hmm.
And then within a matter of like 5 to 10 seconds, all that goes to waste. You will
not kill my
ally. Now we lose control of outside of garage, and we lose control of mid. And then we side because our team's not carrying us.
No. I side because I knew I should have been behind that Phoenix. I remember this moment very clearly. You saw me hesitate, like I was going to run into garage through the connector, right? And then I backed off, right? Because I was scared. I was scared of someone walking up C-Long. I'm always scared of someone walking up C-Long. And then as soon as my Phoenix died, I was like, yeah, that was my fault. I know that was my fault. Like, 100,000%, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say, bullet point number 4, not taking advantage of map control. Your team gains. Next. Okay, now 1 or 2v5. The bomb hasn't been planted yet, so you do have some time. We're semi-playing off our jet. Well, at least we were playing off our jet, like around here. We're ready to trade it. We're ready to trade it. Great, perfect. I like it. Then we sit back for some reason. Okay, now we're really sitting back. Okay, now we're planning A. Okay, so now we need to communicate to our jet and ask her, do you want to commit to this? Like, do you want to commit and actually win the round 2v4? Or do we want to save this round? Because, you know, maybe we're low on credits, or maybe we can do more damage, like, economically to the enemy instead of trying to win the round outright.
Yep.
But since you guys aren't communicating, I'm assuming that you're just gonna both hard commit to this 2v4. You gotta be faster, too slow. Like, Jet is like all the way on there, and we're nowhere to help. So this is where, like, communication coordination comes into play, where, like, tell your Jet, hey, wait a few seconds, I'm putting a star down. Or something like that, I don't know. Just, like, try to communicate with your Jet so that she's not going in alone. Or if she is going alone, then no longer, the stars are no longer important, like. As soon as you see this, like, see her positioning, put the star, fine, but then, like, she's, like, she continues holding W. She continues holding W, and then she dashes.
Where she exit and follow her.
Yeah, this is where you exit and follow her, because your star is no longer useful. Even if you get the star off, she's gonna commit to a fight, like, right now. So your best value play is to hold W with her.
Yeah.
Okay, like, you can't even, like, use your star. You're originally thinking you're gonna smoke, you're gonna concuss, whatever. But you can't, because now Jet is like on top of the star. I think you're too afraid. I think you could have killed that. Okay, you did the... Was that concuss? Yeah, it was a concuss. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, it's pull. I can never tell. Huge? Okay, now you need 1v2. Now again, you need to ask yourself the same question. Do I try to commit to this, win the 1v2, or do I save and try to get easy kills? If you do decide to save, I would not stay CT spawn. I would rotate to through mid and cut off their T spawn exit.
Okay.
But here we're just gonna commit, okay? If you're gonna commit, you can't walk. You have to run. If you're gonna commit, like, the bomb's ticking down, you're committing to defusing the bomb, you don't have time to walk. Okay, so now we're safe, but now it's too late, because now they're gonna rotate through T-spawn, and we're not gonna get those exit kills that we could've gotten. Or maybe we can't, because they're dumb and pushing through CT-spawn. Well, they're in B right now. Okay, yeah, they're just dumb. Nice. They're just dumb as shit, okay? But good kills otherwise. But, yeah, you definitely deserve those.
No, of course not.
Oh crap. Actually, we're going to fast this what happened. Okay. Jet ulted. Well, the enemy jet ulted. Oh, and then, okay, let's see the economy. What do we got for guns? So that's really important. We have Sage's bots. Everyone wants. We have a Silver and a Spectre. We have a Phoenix and a Shardy. And the Jet has a Shorty. So you and the Sage have the big guns on the team. What you should do is that you should play near, like, you want your Vandal, you and your Sage's Vandal, to be in as many gunfights as possible.
Yeah.
Right? See what I mean by that? So you don't want to have happen where, like, you're sitting at B site, holding an angle, but the whole enemy team is, like, they W key onto A site, they kill your Sage, they kill your Sova, and now your Vandal is much less useful.
Mm-hmm. Yes. How would I do that? Like, do I predict? Do I just move around the map a lot to wherever the fight is?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Moving on a lot. Addendum to this is because your team is on an eco round, by default, your team is gonna lose the round. If you just, like, play your normal game, most likely you're gonna lose the round because your Silver Spectre, your Phoenix, the shotgun is gonna get outclassed in general against a rifle.
Yeah.
So yeah, you and or your team needs to, like, play more aggressive, needs to make a play so that the round becomes more winnable. Whether that's, like, you push out, you seek engagements, ideally with a teammate. So, like, you try to force, like, a 2v1 to happen, or like you push out and, like, you try to gain as much information as possible. Like, you play in a good position to get as much information as possible.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Get out of my way. Here's an example. Look at your Sage. Your Sage is pushing two stories. She's thinking, I need to make a play to get information. If I can for sure know that nobody is coming A, that frees up my Sova to, for example, to leave A and then rotate out. Or maybe Sova can like push up with me and then we'll push out of A lobby or something like that.
Right. So I do have a question. Like my Phoenix is like really, really like proactive. He's making all these plays, like he's taking map control. My Sage like is understanding the value of her gun and like taking these fights. And there's just nothing going through my head. My head is completely empty right now, right? Like, why am I even in gold? I like this makes me kind of sad, but like, yeah, I do need to work on this.
Well, I don't want to be brutally honest, but this is why you're gold.
right.
Because you have to think about all these things, and that's what separates like a gold player from like a high level player. Where like a high level player is juggling like 10,000 things at once, and like trying to come up with the most optimal play or the most optimal decision with out of like 10,000 variables to think about. Yep. Whereas like the average player is going to think about like maybe like a handful of it. Okay, so let's see how this plays out.
Oh crap.
Yep, so Phoenix is up ACP. Very nice. Okay, this tells me there's a hard B hit. And then hopefully you communicate to your team, but you haven't. And then also your second job is to break the wall ACP, so that the enemy team has to like be worried. It slows down their push, slows down their exit. Maybe they have to keep someone on site because they're worried that you're nearby. You might like trade someone out, like kill someone on their way out or something like that.
But yes, usually my instinct is to break the wall immediately. I don't know why I didn't do that here. I think it's because the wall represented safety for me, like in this particular space, because I'm alone against like five people on site, right? Almost four at this point, but yeah.
Yes, but the safety also goes both ways. And what you could do is that you can break the wall and then like sort of like peek the wall where you're standing, kind of, but you also have a semi escape route because you have a smoke next to you or you have a corner next to you. And generally when teams like put a wall, they don't want to push past their own wall. Even if it's broken, they want to push past it. They're putting the wall because they want to like not worry about that part of the map or that part of the bomb site.
Yes.
That's why the wall is going down or going up rather. Okay, so let's see how this plays out. So plan B, we know that for sure A lobby is completely clear because Sage has pushed through it completely. Jet is relatively quick to rotate. She's realized it. Quick kill. Yeah, what happened to Phoenix? Phoenix is pushing out with a shotgun, I assume. Spike planted. He's probably gonna run into the woman. Okay, never mind. Run into the Sage. Okay, now we know the Sage is mid, or like below window, and then Omen is in window. And now the Sova is on site. So what you can do is that this is an isolated fight that you can take with the Sova because his team is nowhere to help him. Tell your Sova, hey, push with me, or hey, drone, if you have a drone available, right? Tell him that this Sova is alone, let's push him 2v1. And this should be very easily winnable. That's a huge tag, you know exactly who he is. Nice, good trade. Let's see what happened to our Sage. Sage dies, unfortunate. We should push too quickly. Now a Jet brings his dash. Okay, now you know the last two people are mid. And we haven't picked up our star. So again, minor issue that's becoming a major issue is that you're not picking up utility as soon as they're not in useful positions anymore. Right now, like it'd be really useful to use your three stars to help you, like you can smoke off mid and then tap the bomb. You can like put a concussive blast like where you expect them to be, like you expect them to be in window. And then blast them, and then like peek off of it, maybe get a kill. Put a concussive blast like below window, maybe get a kill off of that. Like all these things that you can do with these stars, but the problem is you don't have any stars available.
Yeah.
So now, the only thing you can do is ult. I also don't like that ult because it's too far out. You're giving them multiple options.
What?
One thing I'd like to do is that you can put your wall, but then just tap the bomb, because one thing about the wall is that they can't hear, or they can like barely hear the bomb tap at all. So
okay.
Basically, as soon as the wall goes up, they have to assume that you're on the bomb, you're defusing the bomb, whatever, until they face check it, right?
Right,
that's really the only way that they're going to know for sure, because like it muffles auto like so much that they can't just like rely on the tap. Yeah, so like as soon as the wall goes up, I would like almost assume that they're going to push through it, and I would position myself in such a way that you would basically like off angle and kill them as soon as they walk through the wall.
Yeah.
They plant up your wall. So let's talk about that for a couple minutes. Let's see. So knowing that, change the screen. We are in B sites. And unfortunately, we put the wall like this. Okay?
Yes.
What we can do, we can stand here, or we can stand here. As soon as they walk through, you get this perfect 90-degree angle on them. Where like they're pushing through, they're super focused on the bomb that's planted here. They're not really looking left or right. So this is an easily 1v1, isolated 1v1, unless they happen to push at the exact same time. If they do, then they also line up, so they could also possibly die at the exact same time as well.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I see a lot of Astras doing this in professional play. Yeah.
But if you were to do that play, a better option, instead of like giving them multiple options to like push through the wall, is that you give them exactly one option that they're gonna be okay, so imagine if the bomb is here. There's a kind of a sage wall that was put here. What if we put the wall like this? Right? Now they're thinking, if I wanna check the bomb, this is my option, and I'm standing here. Well, okay, actually, let me not make the wall like too much like that. Let me give it a different angle like that, so that you can stand here. And now, when they face check it, like, these are the options. They're like right in front of you, trying to face check the bomb.
Mm-hmm. That's big brain.
Like, this would be like a super high, like, you could probably clutch the round with this type of wall. What's likely to happen because of solo queue is that one person is going to push through, face check it. The other person is going to be a little bit smarter and be like, oh, I can just like go around here and like peek from here just in case you're in the middle. But by the time that happens, you kill this guy. That's isolated 1v1. When that happens, now you back up and you play along on this corner or something.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you basically hard abuse your wall because they don't know if you're actually on the bomb or not. Okay. Okie dokie.
Wow.
And by the way, I don't actually play Astra, but just some thoughts that just come to my mind. Okay. If I were to play Astra, right?
One outside grass.
See, do we see our gun loadouts? Okay, so we have an operator. We have Sage who's fully bots. Again, we have to have the same thinking. We want to be in as many gunfights as possible. We want to be thinking, how can I get a gun upgrade to my Phoenix? How can I get a gun upgrade to my Silva? Right now, my Phoenix, my Silva playing A. So A is actually, even though it's double stacked, it's lightly defended right now.
One outside grass.
Just open.
Phoenix is making a play, so we should push with him. Unfortunate.
Locking vision.
I mean, if we're sure two people are A, we saw the jet, we saw the sage. Reyna was mid, last seen maybe 10 seconds ago. She's probably gone by now. At least two people in the lobby. Okay, at least one person in the lobby. Two people. Now it's just a Reyna's unknown.
Spike down A.
Spike's down. Okay, let's ignore everything else. Just rotate to the bottom. We don't know if Reyna's B though. She could be mid. Nice, yeah. Keep it going on.
Yep.
Okay, they're rotating off. So that means that we can just like, instead of holding this angle, we should play more unexpected angle because of the map control that we just got. That we can like push underneath the window. Or we can...
Yeah.
Yeah, probably pushing underneath the window is probably the safer bet. If you know for sure that they're not there, then you can either push into window or you can push to the right side and go do bottom mid.
Mm-hmm.
But now we know exactly where the rain is, so now we know exactly where the last two people are.
Oh, one's on fucking.
Now this window is no longer that important. We need to either go for jets or push through window to like wrap behind them. And if we're planning to go for a jet, we need to keep on FL. Here we're running out with our gun, but nobody's gonna come out here. Nobody's gonna pop up when across here unless jet dies first.
Okay.
One enemy remaining. Very nice, good 2v1. Last position is unknown unless... Okay, yeah, I guess Silver saw him. Or not. Silver just randomly pinged. Okay, so we decided to go for a jet. Not necessarily a bad idea. We have the stars in the right spot this time. Okay, okay. I think you're a little too committed to the fight. Not necessarily that you missed, but because like here, you see them, you spray them because they're not looking at you. As soon as they start looking at you, you should hide. As soon as she's looking at you, you should hide. You managed to survive, but you could have died, and then now your team's in a 1v2, or a 2v1 rather, instead of a 3v1.
Yeah.
So you want to take...
Yeah, like, I only survived because I got legged through a wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you want to take like the free stuff, like here you're getting some free shots, whether you miss or don't miss, like doesn't really matter. What matters is that like you take advantage of it, but you still stay safe. Like you don't commit to this. Here you're crouching, you're spraying, you're too committed.
Yeah.
So not even talking about aim yet, just talking about like other game sense things, like how much you should commit to a fight, whether you should commit to a fight or not.
Mm-hmm. Good stuff, guy.
Okay, other half, pistol round.
obscuring vision. Enemy
A. One thing is that I don't like to stay in astral thingy, because you can always activate the stars, like, outside of this view.
Yeah.
What you want to do is like just be in this view, just to place the stars, place them as fast as possible, then get out of this view and start running with your team. Because what's going to happen is that you're still in this view, and now your team's like already entering onto site. Whereas you can also enter onto site and like activate the stars at the same time, just by looking at them through the wall. So far our only value is just like popping the stars down. And then here we're running with a pistol out, which is not as fast as a knife. Here we've passed the orb, which we could have gotten. Oh, what was that other star? Okay, this always a beam it, okay. Okay, let's see. So there's a sage and a reina. I see the spawn. Smoke's positions are very good. We should grab this ghost and set our feet. We should grab the ghost at our feet. We should smoke something. Oh, we have a spot to go. Never mind.
One heaven. One careful, no. One enemy
remaining. We should beat that. Ooh, okay.
Yeah, big mistake.
I mean, you can juggle it for information, but peeking like this is a really wide peek. You're exposed to the entirety of window.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, that could have ended very poorly. That could have been like a 1v1, Reyna heals, then Reyna kills your Silver with full health. You also didn't pick up the gun at your feet at all.
Don't worry. Don't think it, eh?
There's the awareness again.
Awareness. Becoming a bigger and bigger issue.
Up I go.
I don't really like this 5-stacking, but it seems like you don't really have a choice.
Enemy spotted A.
You should go with your Phoenix. Here your team does a split, which is generally what you should be doing when you're like executing A or executing C. Last round, you guys like 5-man A, but like A long, but you don't know if somebody could have been sewers. Here, the Phoenix is going alone at sewers. Somebody should go with him, because what could happen is that he could run into a 1v1, and nobody chases him out, and then he gives up his gun to the enemy, which would be really bad on enemy save rounds.
Yeah.
And just like that, yep, Phoenix is dead. Reno probably has his gun now. Really lucky that Jet gets a trade. Now we see three people on site. We should probably commit to our team, like, hey, we need to get the fuck out of here. Like, there's too many people at A site, we should get out, rotate to C or something.
Okay.
The clutch.
Nice.
Okay, so you just managed to clutch her out with, like, better aim, better guns.
Yeah, but obviously that wasn't the right play, right?
The right play is to play safer. Go yep, where, the, go so, where yeah. the enemies aren't. Instead of like forcing gunfights, if you don't have to take the gunfight, then don't take it.
Mm-hmm.
Without a star, I cannot pulling them in.
Like the ball. See, this is why I don't like now. You guys are doing the complete opposite. Like before, like you were like hard dubbing, you were hard committing. Playing super aggressive when you had like better guns, but now you guys are playing super passive when you have like shitty guns. Generally when you have shitty guns, you're like, you want to play more aggressive actually, and like take gambles so that you can like maybe you win a 1v1 and now your team gets a Vandal. Maybe you win a 1v1, your team gets a Phantom or something like that. And then your Spectre, you give your Spectre to your Phoenix. Now Phoenix has a Spectre instead of a Marshall, right? So like over time your team like slowly gets like gun upgrades. And then the round becomes more and more winnable. Or the round becomes like, you can like get more and more value out of the round.
Yeah.
But like here, like you're peeking B, it made sense when like you did your suck. Because that's like a huge advantage for you. Here you double peek. Okay, great. You don't see anybody, but now you peek again. Now the suck is over. Now if somebody was there, if they had a Phantom or a Vandal, like you just get one or two taps. And your Spectre, well, unless you have like perfect aim or something, like you're just gonna lose the fight.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, now this would be a really bad good fight to take if someone peeked out. Okay, looks like your team is about to exit garage. The need star is ASAP. And you didn't give him a star. And now Jet had to use her own smoke to smoke the window, which your star should have smoked, or your star should have concussed or something.
Yeah. Jets rotating.
But now they basically took garage control without any of your utility. To,
like yeah, Jets out there.
Okay, we know that stage is to our right. Hey lobby, now there's a whole gunfight happening in garage. We're not really a part of it. We've done gotten zero value over here so far. Okay, great, we got a gun. Get the gun. ASAP. Too slow. We're peeking this long range. That's not what you want to do as a Spectre. With a Spectre. You want to peek close range angles. Get the gun. Wait it out. They're going to expect you to be here. Yeah. Too slow. Tiny nitpick, why the delay?
I'm thinking, is this a good idea? Where exactly do I want to smoke? Like, close or far? Like, what do I want to do? I'm just like, I'm not that quick when it comes to making decisions. So
yeah,
that's where the delay is coming from. Yeah.
Again, ideally, you want to put your stars down as fast as possible and then leave this view as fast as possible so that you can, like, be with your team.
Yeah, yeah.
But hey, well, like, it seemed like you're thinking about whether I should even put the star or not. Okay, we put the stars. Now, our team's, like, already executing. Our Jet's on site. Phoenix got pick. Concealment. Ain't nobody summoning CT spawn. Yeah, shoot the dart. Tell your Sova to come plants. What the fuck is he doing?
Wait, I've spiked.
Okay, you know there's two CT spawn. Unfortunately, nobody was peeking with our Jet. Why is our Phoenix hiding? Oh, he's worried about C-Long. Okay, that's fine. I do like keeping somebody C-long, so like, here your whole team is like pushing onto site. I do like to keep somebody at C-long so that they can feel safe. Yep. Maybe that's what Tesoro was thinking. And then, okay, so your Jett and Sage pushing to garage. 2v1, awesome. Sage just shot in the back, unfortunately, so now Jett's behind us. No, there's two CT spawn, the fourth guy is unknown. Unfortunately, nobody trades out our Jett.
Enemy
remaining. Nice! So, it's a little bit on your Phoenix. Your Phoenix is like too focused on C-Long. I think either someone should go C-Long or your Phoenix just needs to like trade out his teammates. Like, he should trade you out immediately, he should trade out the Jett immediately. So, yep. That's obviously not on you, but yeah. Seems like you did your job. Okay, let's see. We press tab again? No. We press tab here. Okay. So we have three fully kitted rifles, and unfortunately Sora has a bulldog. He probably should have requested from Phoenix to get a gun.
And someone mentioned that in the round and he's like, nah, I'm okay. Okay. So yeah.
Okay, so we have three fully kitted people and one almost fully kitted person. Mm-hmm. And the enemy team, what's more important is the enemy team is like on a full save. Most likely on a full save.
Yeah, yeah.
So let me ask you, what are you thinking?
Like a default. That's what I'm thinking. Like we should probably like play more like passively look to take map control. I think I even say that in chat like in a few seconds. But like, yeah, okay. We should. Yeah.
Okay. What else? What is that?
We should know that they're gonna probably do something cheesy or funny to like try and get a gun off us, right?
Okay.
And we should be prepared for that. So I'm thinking to take like longer gunfights, I guess.
Okay, so like long range gunfights, okay. Good.
Yeah.
What else?
Other than that, other than that, like, well, honestly, that's the only thing I'm thinking of in game. I can probably come up with something now, but like that's like the only thought that's going through my head when I'm playing.
Okay, so in general, when the enemy team, you have the right idea that you want to take long range gunfights because you're expecting them to have short range guns or pistols or shotguns or whatever, and mm-hmm. you're expecting them to do something cheesy to steal a gun. Right? These are all perfectly reasonable assumptions and definitely in the right play. So the way that we accomplish that is that besides taking long range gunfights, is that we want to deny the enemy from picking up these guns, right? So we want to deny the enemy from getting, like, let's say, like, if Jett pushes into garage, we want to make sure that she's not pushing alone. Like, worst that can happen is she pushes alone, she finds herself in, like, a 1v2 where, like, someone's holding close garage plus somebody's in garage window. Maybe she gets a kill, maybe she doesn't, but she dies and she gives up a gun. That's what you don't want to have happen.
Yeah, yeah.
So throughout the round, defaulting is fine. You just, like, throughout the round, you want to pay attention to, play very close attention to where your team is positioned, where they're headed, and, like, any risks that they might be about to take. And, like, think about what you can do to help alleviate those risks. Whether it's you go with them to trade them out, or you smoke something, so maybe you smoke the garage window, so Jett doesn't have to worry about garage window. Instead, she just worries about the close range, like directly to her left when she pushes the garage.
Mm-hmm.
So things like that is gonna like basically make or break the round, because if like one or two guns go to enemy team, then suddenly the round is like perfectly losable.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Okay, good idea. Hide the bomb. I like it.
Get out of my way. I have this bike.
So I'm thinking here, like we're using util on C, we're aggressing C, we've got a little bit of control here. We're pushing them off. I should move towards C.
Nice. Yeah, let's go.
And then that happens.
Great, awesome. You see, you got two picks. One of them actually bots. So this is perfect. You guys are all grouped up, minus the Jett, but Jett doesn't matter because she runs a shorty.
Right here.
honestly, I think Jet's probably like a smurf because like he's like getting all these kills with just a shorty.
One enemy remaining.
Yeah.
Down A.
Okay, what happens? Anything's happening really fast. Smoke CT, smoke heaven. I don't know why we have knife outs. So listen clear. Okay, so you wanted to plant the bomb as fast as possible, but then your team just lost like every 1v1.
Yeah.
Let's see what happened. Do we have any utility? Or he darted or something. Okay, he drones. Unfortunate, we don't have drone available anymore. Let's see. Did he dart? He darted. Okay, unfortunately, you don't have dart anymore. So that's a little bit on your. Well, I guess he wasn't expecting your stage to get 3 picks. So that's why he doesn't have any initiator utility available.
Yeah. I should probably like try and plant closer to the box. I wouldn't have died then.
Yeah. I think it's just like your team just like lost everyone. Your Sage died, everyone, and you're unable to trade it out because you iced out, unfortunate. Now your Sova and your Phoenix are like not able to win any 1v1s.
He's in CET.
Yeah, so this is kind of your team just like lost the pistols there.
Thank you.
Well, actually, then again, the Sage did buy, and then someone else bought a Spectre. So, knowing that, I would actually hit A again because, you know, like, punish their Sage for not having a gun for this round.
Yeah.
I'm in the hot seat.
Follow me. Your team does have 5 ults, so you can basically like hard execute any way you want.
Oh. Don't be good.
Unfortunate. So, when the new team has money for an op, they had money, right?
Yes, they did. Couple people had 6k. Yeah.
Yeah, she had 6k. So, especially on a jet play, expect to have an op. Ideally, it would be like the Sova should dart or the Sova should drone first. Initiator should spend utility to like to make first contact with those angles.
Mm-hmm.
But if that doesn't happen, what you can do is that you can put stars, and also your Phoenix needs to wait for this drone. Yeah, he drive peaks. Okay, that's the issue. He drive peaks without waiting for the drone.
Don't peek it.
Okay, so now that we know that C is being held down with an op. Now your team, you and your team needs to decide, do we continue committing to this? And if we do, then okay, start putting more stars and preparing to deal with this operator. If not, we need to just rotate the hell out of here. Because the longer we stay here, the more map control that the enemy team could get right now. Like someone could be pushing up A lobby, somebody could be pushing up B mid. We have no idea because we're all stacked at C long.
Yep.
So we need to commit to a decision like ACP. Okay, so the Jet's running out. She's making the decision. She's taking me to get the hell out of here. There's no point in staying around.
Right. I was just watching the minimap like being entertained by the server ult. I had my brain turned off completely. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So now we see that we're too slow because the enemy team has pushed out of all, and gained map control that we kind of gave up. Now and then also the Jet has the right idea. Like Jet is the first person, which makes me think even more that she's a smurf, that she's making the right decision to just avoid C long, because there's no way that we're going to deal with this operator unless like you have some big brain play.
Yeah.
So that she's automatically thinking I'm just going to wait it out, but unfortunately the rest of the team is just like sitting around, like you're just looking at this wall thinking, oh, do I smoke B mid for some reason, and this Jet is just watching A lobby, and then now the Jet dies for no reason and nobody's ever traded out. Yep, so now there's definitely two people outside garage. Now you've all been spotted.
Okay.
Now there's three people outside of garage. You commit to this, you don't commit to this. Yeah. Yeah, so the issue of this round is that you guys are playing too slow.
Unfortunate. Do we need a half buy?
And also that the enemy team has shown that as soon as you guys make contact on a site, then they're going to push it out of the other site. They're going to push garage. They're going to push a lobby. So either you guys continue defaulting, or you develop some sort of play around that. Yeah. Like maybe you guys do the same thing. You make some light contacts, like you jump peek out of C-Long, but you keep somebody outside of garage, or you keep somebody outside of a lobby and just like kind of wait for the push.
We need to get a pick and yeah.
You just got jets open, so it's kind of hard to go.
We'll go short. I can go short and open.
Nah, no, I don't always save run. So
good.
Let's see now. Covering it.
Nice, big tech, love it. Unfortunate. Enemy jets, really smart, good positions.
Ops down.
Don't reload, I would just burn ult right away. So like here, you guys are obviously hard committing. Even though your sage is dead, you're just hard committing because you guys are an eco, just take the rest, doesn't matter. And then we get to here, we kill the jet. Now, based on where our Phoenix is, we're like, he's like ready to burst into sight like as soon as possible. So like the best thing you could do right now is just like burn your ult and just like secure the site. And like use the ult so he can push into sight. Okay, so he's a bit smarter, he's a bit more patient this time. Now we ult, but now it's kinda late. Now there's at least two people here, three people here, because it's the Sova, Arena, and now Sage. Omens unknown. I'm playing too far back. Again, the Spectre is a close range. You want to be hugging these boxes.
Yeah.
So that you're as close as possible to your enemy. Let's go back to a little bit. So imagine if like you're here. Imagine the eyeball was in there. And like you kind of peek into like the CT spawn area, but even though it's like kind of walled out, right? If someone like peeked you here, you're most likely gonna lose a gunfight because you're fighting a Spectre at mid to long range, more like mid range, whereas they have a Phantom, or they have a Vandal, which would just like completely out damage you and completely outspare you.
Mm-hmm.
You want to be like your Phoenix here. Your Phoenix is hugging this this box here, which unfortunately you guys got flashed, but the right play is to hug this so that you abuse the close range advantage of your Spectre. Just like this. Yeah. I would even just like walk into the smoke, because you don't necessarily want to play. I mean, you do kind of want to play around the smoke, but you don't want to find yourself in a longer range gunfight because you're walking around the smoke.
Mm-hmm.
You want to force close range, as close as possible.
I like that.
Means your mic. Obscuring vision.
Okay, seems like we're defaulting right now. The only issue is that the enemy has shown that they're not gonna peek out until like action happens on elsewhere on the map. Yep. Also, your Phoenix is did he even flash? Let's see. Or did he just walk in? Her dart?
He's not inside garage. He's outside.
Okay, so he's walking in because Silva darted. And dart broke immediately, so that probably told Phoenix where the enemy was. Okay, so the garage is clear.
Nice.
He makes a huge play. That's the contact. So now, probably at this point, I would expect the enemy to be pushing A. If they would have pushed, this would be the time to do it. But not if your sage is stomping around. And not if you're stomping around. At this point, I would consider, like, it's a little bit too late now, but like, as soon as Phoenix got that pick, and as soon as your team, like, secured, like, your Phoenix has control of garage right now, you guys can just be like, okay, no more defaulting, let's rotate over to C, and then do like a 3-2 split.
Yes, okay.
Unless, like, you're really banking on the enemy to be pushing in lobby, like, the more guaranteed play is to make use of your garage control right now, which you just lost, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we've switched over. We're gonna be thinking about a B hits. Generally, I wouldn't smoke like this because Sage can always wall one side, which I would expect her to do.
jetpack is
up. Well, maybe she's saving her wall, I don't know.
One enemy remaining. Nice.
And the enemy was punished. Generally, I would smoke one side and let Sage wall the other.
Okay, yeah.
Unless you know for sure she doesn't have wall, then okay, then smoke both sides.
Right. Should I tend to smoke close or smoke the link door?
Smoke the link door.
Okay. Yeah. Gives us more space to work with, right?
Yeah.
Gun
here. It might be a different story if you still had your Phoenix alive, because like you can smoke close and then like you guys can just, like position yourself inside the smoke, and then Phoenix can like pop flash out and you guys burst out. That would be like a huge play.
Rhinos out.
Saw some in sewers.
Dead.
Oh, very risky.
Rhinos out.
I actually would have just like jiggled. Oh, what the heck happened?
Dead. Okay. Was that like too wide of a swing?
No, it's because she saw you. She sees you. Or I don't know. Maybe she sees the jet as well. So it's hard to say. But I'm kind of assuming as soon as I see the Reyna, because she was looking in this direction, she probably saw me as well. So therefore, she's focused on me. That means that if I peek out, I'm going to be the first thing that she sees. Instead, I want to just, like, either stay here, wait for my teammate to, like, make contact, and then I swing out. Or I jiggle to continue baiting her attention to let my teammate swing out and get the kill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, basically, one person acts as bait. Right now, I feel like you're the bait because she was looking at you, but I'm not entirely sure. Maybe she was looking at the jet instead. But the general idea is have one person act as bait while the other person commits to the kill.
Rhinos, out.
But here, like, you peek out, commit to the kill, and then, I don't know, maybe she was looking at Jet, I'm not sure.
Spike drop. I have the spike. I felt pretty confident in peeking because I knew my Jet was behind me, but, I didn't really know what was going on or whether I deserved the kill or not. Obscuring vision. Phoenix make a huge play.
Yeah, got one of my belt. At this point, you pop the smokes, like even before you pop the smokes, your Sova and your Jet are way ahead of you. There's no point switching to your gun. You're not going to be in a gunfight for the next at least 10 seconds.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, you also could have gotten the orb.
Very nice.
Nice. There's one.
Okay, at this point, I would just go back C-Long and like hold the flank. The other option is to like go with one of your teammates and trade them out. So if you're not going to play C-Long, then either you go with your Phoenix or you go with your Jet. Both of them are making a play right now by pushing past like the safety zone. Safety zone being in sight.
One CT,
I will go with your Phoenix. Guaranteed value. He's very likely to make a... get into a gunfight, and he's going to need help. It's too far away though. This angle made sense when it was smoked out and when he was positioned here, but as he's moving to the left, I would start moving up closer.
Yeah.
And as the smoke dissipates, I would definitely move up closer. Because if we're still standing here, he's pushing out. Now, like, now this position, there's no way for us to trade him.
Yeah.
There's no way, he dies, we can't do anything about it. We're just, like, completely useless. And we're droning, he died to an operator. And the Jet is in a 3v, like a 1v3 situation, so it's very unlikely that she's going to try to defuse the bomb. I would basically expect her to save her operator, but in doing so, I would basically position myself to like leave the bomb as fast as possible, and cut off any exit points that she has.
Yeah.
So right now, the only exit point that she has that's not covered by a teammate is A-Link.
Okay.
So basically, I would run through CT spawn and cut that off, ACP. Like, run for knife out. Exactly, yeah.
I have that idea, but I think it's a bit too late.
This is still too slow. Even here, I would keep running for knife out, because I wouldn't expect the Jet to stay here. And then, worst case scenario, if she does, you can jiggle peek each of these corners. Like, jiggle peek this corner that you end up, like, kind of swinging like this. You should jiggle peek that with your knife, so that if she is holding this angle with her operator, she'll be more likely to miss, or like she you bait a shot or you keep her like staying here while the rest of your team continues like continues boxing her in, boxing her in.
Yeah.
She's not likely to be here because their jet already cleared this. She's not likely to be backside either because you're still already droned in, so she's gotta be A site. Or A lobby now.
Nice.
So you had the chance to deny the operator, but it kinda slipped away.
Yeah.
Okay, let's look at the money situation. So the enemy team is broke. The only person you can buy is Salt, is a Sage. Although they're more likely to save. Although maybe because it's 11-10, they might force, who knows. But the big issue is that they have an operator which shuts down like a lot. Like you just can't like go see long anymore because you have to worry about the jet having an operator. And you can't like dry peak like A long anymore for the same reason.
Spike, nice.
Like, both of those positions would be really ideal for your team because like you can hard abuse your gun advantage.
Yeah, but now we can't do that. But
now you can't do that.
My ult's going to slow.
Okay.
So I'll watch my body.
Okay, so Phoenix is thinking like he's going to make a huge play.
One day or four.
Yep. You guys need to spend some utility to be able to cross this. I like the idea that you had before.
So watch
but, like,
my body.
You put a star like right here. Like right in front of you so that they can cross safely and then just like take the star back. So it actually doesn't even cost you anything.
Yeah.
And then you'll be able to have your team like safely cross.
One day or four.
But unfortunately your jet dies to the operator. And now the Phoenix is executing a site and like this is like completely not coordinated. Like your Phoenix is already on site and your team is not following up. And you're not following up either. Okay, so we know the site is likely to be cleared, or maybe not because its rain is still there. But now the jet is less likely to be useful, I think. I think she used her dash. Not sure. Okay, I guess we're not sure if she used her dash or not.
Rain is stunned.
Rain is stunned. Oh, you do have a star. Should we use star heaven?
One heaven.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, like this push is like too slow. And then okay, let's see when do we actually activate the heaven smoke. We did the pull. Phoenix is already inside. Okay, now we smoke heaven. We smoked heaven at like 124. Our smoke only lasts like 15 seconds. Our push is like kind of halted. At this point, our potato is re-smoking. Yeah, this smoke's gone now.
One heaven?
Yeah.
Sage is heaven?
But the main issue is the execute's like, they're too slow. People are going in one at a time.
Tag 120.
And just play together and they'll fall apart.
Yeah, and you guys had the gun advantage too.
Wait for
like,
each other.
Like, that should have been a very easy round and then you guys burned two ults and you still lost the round.
Great team.
Okay, so we're back to defaulting. Okay, Jet's making a play, we're gonna push her through. Should be very obvious, she's just like ulting in your face. She's gonna make a play. Or maybe not, maybe she's just wants to hold bottom mid. Here I wouldn't actually peek this because look at our Sage. A Sage is on top of this thing. So we don't actually wanna hold this angle like this. And definitely not this wide.
Okay.
Because what's going to happen is that we're going to find ourselves in an isolated 1v1 and our Sage can't trade us out.
Yeah.
Instead, we want to happen the other way. We want our Sage to make the first contact. Then when we peek out, we can force it to become a 2v1.
Yes. Just geometry, right?
Yeah, geometry. Simple geometry.
Okay. Great pick, Phoenix.
Phoenix is making a pick. We should just... I would just commit to C.
Phoenix.
I would, as soon as the pick happens, I would just like, yeah, run over to Phoenix. I would tell the team, hey, the rest of you guys just push through garage. You're all in a great position to go garage. Just go garage. I'll smoke off your garage window. I'll smoke off CT. We hit C together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Alright. I think we can go back to A. Maybe? Oh, no. Garage. We've got garage control, right?
So we know that's over CT, we know that Sage is in window. Ideally, your team would have noticed this and then listened to your call and gone A, but because they don't really give a crap about that, they're just going to go garage. Then we should just, like, continue with the plan of, like, going C.
Yeah.
We're too focused on this. Just let Jet handle garage window. Just go into sight.
Yeah.
Okay, now there's three enemies here. The only person that we haven't seen is Reyna. These targets are too slow. Back it's not side. Very useful because your team is like already entering sight.
It's on sight.
Here, your solo is already in a gunfight. Now your sage is peeking out, already in a gunfight. Okay, now we know where everyone is. Everyone is either on site or CT spawn. So the sage is probably still CT spawn or outside garage or something.
Yeah.
Or C-Link rather. But like this whole time, we're putting stars down and activating them. Our team's already in gunfights.
Nice.
That we're not part of. We're not helping.
One enemy remaining.
CT.
I would run away. I would run away.
What was that noise, bro?
Run away. I mean, you win the gunfight, but it was not necessary because you know where the last guy is? One enemy remaining. Right here. Let's see.
Nice.
One person we haven't seen so far is Sage. I was expecting him to be CT spawn.
He's actually there on log, so don't forget to kill off my stun.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. He's exactly there on logs. Then we want to double peek with our Sova. Unfortunately, it's isolated by me one because the Vayner is smart. And now. We need to just like give up the site and just go A because we know that Reyna is here. There's no way that she's going to be able to like chase us while she's dismissing. She's dismissing and we stick around for her to dismiss. And then we also don't double peek with our jet. You do a double peek, it's a little bit late. But basically this is a gunfight that your team does not have to take.
Sorry,
yeah. I think the main reason why I didn't run away was I thought she was much closer. In my head, she was right behind that box, which is why I was holding that angle like I was.
Yeah.
So I just tracked her incorrectly, I guess. I wasn't aware of her position.
Yeah, it's always risky to, like, force engagements with Arena, even if, like, you're in a 2v1 or 3v1, because especially, like, when she has ults, and then she's going to dismiss, and then now you have no idea where she's going to end up. I mean, maybe if you have vision on her and she's not in ult mode, but you have no idea where she's gonna end up until like the end of the audio queue.
What was that noise, bro? Last player
standing. Like right here, she could have dismissed us again and then deny you that trade instead of healing, which is probably what she should have done.
Yeah.
So if she played it correctly, then she actually could have clutched around.
Nice. Wait, what was that sound there?
sorry, I panicked.
Match point.
Phoenix, your plays are insane, dude.
So let's see what notes we have.
Oh well.
Your plays are insane.
It's awareness.
You're a highly skilled player.
Gap stars.
You just catch a time.
Okay. My new mistake that's becoming a major one is switch screens to look at the notes again. Is that we are spending too much time in Astro mode.
Yeah.
Especially while our team is already executing.
Mm-hmm.
Try to activate stars outside of Astro mode instead.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's a really big one. I play really slowly as Astra because I just have this, I'm stuck in this mindset where I'm like, okay, when I put down a star, I am activating it now. I like that,
And then only use Astral mode to play stars.
Yeah.
And then my issue now is that taking unnecessary gunfights.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. To VLC.
Thanks, man. Good stuff.
Get out of my way.
Nice.
He's making a play already. He kills the omen, and he says, "My ultimate is ready." Nice. He's making a play. He's holding W. Nobody's with him. So unfortunate.
There's two in garage.
Yep, yep.
This is like the best duelist you can like ever hope to have on your team, and then nobody, unfortunately, nobody's with him, ever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we know there's two garage.
There's still garage.
Guys, now we know there's three here. So there's three in garage and C. It's four in garage and C. I would already get the hell out of here. As soon as you saw that silver, I would just give this up. As soon as you see the silver, okay, there's no more of a chance to trade out your silver, because their silver can just like just hide in sight like forever.
Yeah.
At this point, you know what the whole enemy team is. You should just run to A.
Okay, I did not see that. Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but you have 2 tunnel vision on the silver, and then you die.
Yeah.
So, minor issue for now, which it's between minor and major, is not taking into account enemies you've seen either on your screen or minimap. And, not taking into account enemies you've seen either on your screen or minimap, and let's see, we'll phrase it like playing off that information. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, back to VLC. Let's see if our team clutches it. Probably not.
Enemy remaining.
Oh, vulnerable. Oh, your smooth jet. Your jet smooth carried.
Yeah.
Okay, so. Switching screens again to the notes. So what do we have in summary? We have some major issues that this issue, the issue of awareness is like keeps coming up more and more and more, where like a lot of issues are building off of this lack of awareness. Like things are happening on the minimap, things are happening around the map, and we're either not paying attention to it, or we're not taking to our accounts, or we're not adjusting our gameplay based off of that information, and we just continue to play the exact same game as if none of that even happened.
So
both of my O2, we're not playing off our team, our teammates, especially your jet, especially your Phoenix, really especially your Phoenix is like making a play like every single round, like literally every single round, and that's like the best possible duelist you can hope to have on your team. But unfortunately, you're too slow, your team is too slow, or your team like doesn't follow up, your duelist goes in alone, dies, and then most likely your team's gonna be like, "Oh, you Phoenix, you're trash, like why aren't you killing everybody?" Like the issue that keeps coming up is that we're not playing as a team, we're not thinking about where our team is, or where our team is going, what our team is looking at, and thinking about how can I best help my team. Oh, my team is pushing garage, let me smoke garage window. My team is pushing A, let me smoke heaven. My team is pushing C, let me smoke CT spawn. My team is like doing this, let me do that, right? Well, my team is pushing X, let me get close so I can trade them out. So let me cover something that they're cover some other angle so they don't have to worry about it. Something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, so another issue is that the stars need to pick them up ASAP, as we're no longer in a useful position. Too many times you keep putting stars at C long, and it's great if they actually go C long, but you find yourself at B site or you find yourself at A site, and you have zero stars, and you have nothing. The only thing you do is headshot everybody, which is like a complete waste. Because like Astra is like a top tier controller, you can like you have so much like powerful utility to allow you to like control space or contest space, like control it with your smokes or contest it with your suck and your concuss. Like those are really powerful utility, but you just like throw it all away because like your stars are still like across the map. Okay, see what else. Not taking advantage of map control your team gains. Again, this builds off attention, your attention issue, and the issue that your team, like your Phoenix keeps pushing, and he actually wins like a lot of gunfights, and he actually like secures a lot of map control, like especially in defense, but like he pushes through mid, he pushes outside of garage, and then we're still sitting at like C site, and like then you just tell your team, hey, nobody C, You're just acting as like a Saifu cam, basically.
Yeah.
So yeah, don't do that. Like,
yeah.
Take advantage of like the map control that your team is giving you. Take advantage of like the plays that your team is making, and like abuse it. Abuse the fact that you have your Phoenix is in T spawn and cutting off the rotation. Abuse the fact that you have all this map control. You can run in for Nightfall literally anywhere that you want, because you know that all the whole enemy team is like A long, for example.
Yep.
So okay, see what else. Spending too much time in Astra mode. I think I explained it quite a bit. So like again, try to only use Astra mode just to play stars. You can always activate stars like outside of the mode, but you only need the mode just to place the star, and that should like help speed you up so that you're not just like sitting all the way in T spawn or whatever, just placing stars while your team's like entering on site. Instead, you can like place the stars and then be a part of the entry. Well, like you actually like trade out your Phoenix or you trade out your Sova or whatever, right? You start like being more useful than just like just smokes on the ground.
Yeah.
Okay. So those are the main issues. Some other minor issues are is that sometimes you're afraid to look, even though like you've got the information, because you've explained to me that, yeah, you're aware that you could be doing stuff, but like you're too afraid. And sometimes you just have to like take that gamble. Where like if you're on an eco round, for example, you want to take that gamble. You want to like push up, take space, get information, whatever. You don't want to be like playing normal rounds, like playing the same kind of static defense like you kind of were on C sites, where like you have the same two stars and you have the same position where you're sitting back site. You want to be like switching things up. I liked it a lot when like you played B a couple times. You played, I think it was mostly just B. Maybe you played garage like once or twice, but I don't think I ever saw you A.
No.
But definitely like switch things up, like make them think that you could be anywhere, as opposed to expecting you to be at C, at backside C all the time with the same two stars.
Yeah.
Okay, so, and especially because that because her stars are global, your utility is basically global, then you can use your utility anywhere on the map, and then you can position yourself anywhere on the map, which means that you could be looking across the map and still like being useful with your stars. So for example, if your team is like hard pinning to A, you can like walk up C long on attack, and then you still have your stars. You put a star at C spawn, you put a star at A heaven, activate the stars when you see your team is like entering, but at the same time, like you're walking up C long, or you're pushing up C long, whatever, and eventually you find yourself like in a huge flank where like your team, maybe they plant A, they secure themselves at A, and then now you push through C, and now you're in CT spawn, and you're ready to flank behind the enemy team when they start pushing onto A, right?
Mm-hmm.
So things like that. Try to like lurk more. Let's see. Okay, next bullet point: positioning on the open, not near cover or corner. Most of the time, you want to be near a corner. Obviously, you want to be behind cover so that you are not too committed to any engagement that might happen. When you position out in the open, typically you want to do it with like a good reason, because like you want to catch someone off guard. You're playing off of them because you want to catch someone off guard, where you're not in a position that they would expect. But
yes, that is my reasoning for doing that most of the time. Yeah.
But generally, you only want to do this if you have to, because doing this means that you're more committed. This goes into bullet point number three. If you don't have to take a committed gunfight, you don't have to play a committed angle, then don't do it. Play less committed. Like jiggle peek instead. If the enemy is like they're aware of where you are, and they're looking at you and waiting for you to peek, then don't just peek. Just like either continue paying attention, or let a teammate know so that the teammate can swoop in and then like get the free kill while they're focused on you.
Yeah.
And that's the same thing with like number four. Like if you don't have to take the gunfight, then don't take it. It's great if you take the gunfight and your aim is like really good and you can just like headshot everybody, but that's not really consistent. Like once you get to like super high ranks where like everybody can aim, now like if the fight was like, if you can win the round without taking the fight, then why change it to become a 50-50, right? Well, the gunfight could be a 50-50, it could go either way, but you could very easily win the round just by not taking the gunfight, not taking the fair gunfight.
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. I tend to like, I guess, ego peek, I suppose, a lot, because
even though like I say I don't like trust my mechanical skill, I just send it sometimes. I think I can do better, a lot better there.
Yeah. And actually, this bullet point will actually basically ties into awareness. This is basically alpha like number one.
Mm-hmm.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Where like, because your awareness is low, you're not taking into account enemies you've seen either on your screen or your mini-app, and you're not playing off that information. So I've gone through many examples where like, throughout every single round, I've always kept track of the mini-map, I've always kept track of every body, every enemy agent that you've seen, as well as the utility.
Yeah.
So that if an Omen Smoke goes here, well, I guess Omen Smoke is kind of glow, but if you see a Silver Dart, if you see a Sage Wall, a Sage Ice, you know for sure that they're nearby, because they have to be nearby to use that utility. Unless they have like some crazy lineup or something, which is fairly unlikely. And there's many times where like you see like the whole enemy team, you see 1, 2, 3, 4, and eventually you see the whole enemy team on like at garage or like at sea or whatever. And then you don't really think to like to go somewhere else. Right? The best play is always to go where the enemy team is not. Yeah. Instead of running like bashing your head into the enemy team and like voicing gunfights. It's great if you can win every gunfight, but Why take fair fights if you don't have to? You can just take unfair fights. Take the 2v1, take the 3v1. Plant the bomb across the map and force them to like rotate through all this area that they haven't cleared out. Like, yeah. For example, yeah. If you see everybody in garage and see long, tell your teammates to say, hey, keep somebody at B, which is like lurk. Everyone else would just go A, plant the bomb. Now that person who's lurking can get like one or two free kills, and like the enemy team has like, while they're rotating over to A, they have to worry about like 10,000 angles because they decided to like stack C, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So abuse the fact that you abuse when you see all the enemy or most of the enemy, and that should change how you play the round, or that should change how you play, basically your gameplay. Right, so yeah. Those are all the bullet points. I think overall your aim was pretty good. I don't think there were many gunfights that you lost. Actually, there's a lot of gunfights that you won purely because you just tapped them in the head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I spend a little bit too much time playing aim trainers instead of Valorant.
Yeah. So, yeah, and you talk frag too. So your aim is not necessarily like bad, at least mm-hmm. not for a gold rank. So mm-hmm. I would focus more on like all these bullet points here. Definitely probably the biggest major issue is just like building up more and more awareness.
Yeah, I think I need to realize that Valorant is a game of information and not necessarily like, it's definitely not purely about raw mechanics.
Yeah.
And I know there's so much information I can use, but I just don't use it over and over again, and I think like this really exposed that.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Right, sounds good. So yeah, if in the future you have another video or you want to do another interview, just let me know.
I'd love to. Absolutely. Thank you so much for your time, dude. Like, it's amazing what you do for this community.
Yeah, thanks. No problem. All right, I'll stop here.
Yeah. All right. Thanks again.
See ya. Bye.
See you.